Good morning, Axis family. This morning, we have the privilege of hearing from Anthony Torres, one of our very own. This man loves Jesus passionately. He loves his family. He loves the community. And he's going to be guiding us through Psalm 103 today. He graduated from our Pastoral Leadership Collective last year, and I know that the Lord's hand is on him. That's why we've asked him to share with us the gospel from Psalms. So please welcome our very own Anthony Torres.
Good morning. You guys hear me okay?
Yeah.
All right. Thank you. Well, thank you guys. So, yes, my name is Anthony Torres, PLC graduate. That's our Pastor Leadership Collective. And it was such a blessing to be part of that group last year, to get to benefit from just the kind of people that we just heard from. I told Gavin after the last one, I think that'll preach, like we could be done. Thank you. And I'll take a drink first. But we've been Axis Ministry partners here for about 3 years now. My wife, Molly, our kids, Ramona, Ephraim, Felix, Cyrus, and Letty. And I love them. And we love this body. So when I was asked to select a psalm for this series, selfishly, I picked one that I felt I needed to hear. But I hope you can take something from this that you might have a need to dispel really two lies that you might be telling yourself. And one, what is God like? And number two, how he looks at you. So before we dive into our text, let's pray. Father, please remind us of who you really are, that we would evict any lesser God and image that we have painted in our own minds. And may the knowledge of you, what you've done for us, cause us to worship with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's get to work. So this is a psalm from King David, King of Israel. And it's a bit lengthy one, but listen to how he relates to God and how God relates to him. So it starts with, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity, who heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit, who crowns you with steadfast love and mercy, who satisfies you with good, so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. The Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed. He made known his ways to Moses, his acts to the people of Israel. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. For he knows our frame, he knows that we are dust. As for man, his days are like grass, he flourishes like a flower of the field. For the wind passes over it and it's gone, and its place knows it no more. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear him, and his righteousness to children's children, to those who keep his covenant and remember to do his commandments. The Lord's established his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom rules over all. Bless the Lord, O you his angels, you mighty ones who do his word, obeying the voice of his word. Bless the Lord, all his hosts, his ministers who do his will. Bless the Lord, all his works, in all places of his dominion. Bless the Lord, O my soul." So we started and ended with, "Bless the Lord, O my soul." And sandwiched in between, there's the reasons why. So we have the back half, or back four verses, are really about him being the king and the creator of everything and everyone. You know, humanity and these super creatures that just adore him and obey his every word. But then we have the first and 18 verses, however, they are, "He takes care of me." when I do something offensive to him, the way he reveals himself to me is compassionate and gracious. Which brings me to my first point. And there's three points that I want each of us to consider. So one is my perception of God. Two, my perception of how he looks at me. And then three, my response, which is to go back to point two, as we'll see. So one, my perception of God. Now, if I lived in the ancient Near East where the context sits here, and I wanted the gods to take care of me, if I wanted something, if I want children, crops, victory in battle, I need to placate them, right? Give to get. And in the case of Baal or Molech, it could cost me my firstborn. And if Yahweh doesn't pick up the phone, then I'm going to them. And, you know, God's people did this many times over, and are we any better? It's helpful to remember. But none of these gods would crown you with steadfast love and mercy or bring justice for all who are oppressed. Many of them were petty, they had limited power, and they needed food, attention, help with managing the land. And so you would give them what they asked for if you wanted to maintain their emotional stability. And so I had this illustration, most perfect illustration just kind of fell in my lap this week as I was writing this sermon. I was on the porch, it was a sunny morning, and the birds were chirping, and the kids were out, two of them were out coloring, our youngest and our oldest girls. And the youngest, Letty, our three-year-old, like without even looking up from the paper, she's coloring, and she says, "Hey, Ramona, those birds are copying you. We should kill them." I'm just kidding. And don't judge my parenting. But let's contrast that with what we read here. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love. And this is a quote that David is pulling from Exodus 34. So if you hadn't heard this before, Exodus 34, this is verses 6 through 7, is the most quoted section in the Bible by the Bible. So for us, it could be John 3:16, but for them, it was Exodus 34. And it was an answer that God gave to Moses in response to his request, which was, "God, show me your glory." And this was his response. Number one, the Lord, merciful and gracious. I have a quote here from Dane Ortlund, who wrote Gentle and Lowly, which I highly recommend. He said, "God does not reveal his glory as the Lord, exacting and precise, or the Lord, tolerant and overlooking, or the Lord, disappointed and frustrated." It says he's slow to anger. Dane Ortlund, in the same section of Gentle and Lowly, this is my favorite phrase from it, he said he doesn't have his finger on the trigger. It takes much accumulated provoking to draw out his ire. Unlike us, who are emotional dams ready to break, God can put up with a lot. This is why the Old Testament speaks of God being provoked to anger by his people dozens of times. But not once are we told God is provoked to love or provoked to mercy. So his anger requires provocation, and his mercy is pent up, though, ready to gush forth, which connects to this third attribute, abounding in steadfast love. This word hesed, it's a love that inspires compassionate behavior. It's love in action toward another person. And it appears over 250 times in the Old Testament. But we see it most clearly in Jesus. God in the flesh, right? He says in Matthew 11, he says, "Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and lowly in heart." It's the only time in Scripture where he describes himself gentle and lowly. "And you will find rest for your souls." And then we have in Matthew 12, which I love this, as Matthew records him looking over the crowds and then moving in to start healing people. He said it's like the prophet Isaiah foretold, "A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not quench." So his heart toward broken, sinful people is not to recoil or gag, or certainly not to kick them while they're down, but to draw closer and to heal them. Okay, but now here's the more complex part. So we know he's holy and just, his holiness and justice. This psalm doesn't go on. David doesn't continue the quote from Exodus 34 that says, he will by no means clear the guilty, and a number of other things that we don't have time to get into today. But suffice it to say, we know he deals with sin. And even in verse 6 here, it says, the Lord works righteousness and justice for all who are oppressed, which we know is bad news for whoever is talking about with the oppressor in this instance. We know he does not turn a blind eye to things like dishonesty or infidelity any more than he'd turn a blind eye to serial killing, human trafficking, to the demons that possess his people. And so on that same theme, we also see in Psalm 103, he says three different times this phrase, that he's loving and good, all these good things towards those who fear him, those who do his commandments. So I won't lie, the first reading or the second reading of this psalm, this part kind of threw a wet blanket over everything that I had read. And the Hebrew word here, that's how it felt at least, I'll say. And the Hebrew word here, yedeav, those who fear him, this same psalm that grabs you and says, look how steadfast his love is. It's the only psalm that repeats this phrase in three times. And so as much as I want to say that, well, okay, Jesus in the New Testament comes along and it just demolishes this whole paradigm, right? Jesus, being the very nature of God in the flesh, he's only a sharper image of the same God, right? Same image, same God. And what do we see in Matthew 5:17? He says, do not think that I've come to abolish the law or the prophets. I've not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. And in verse 20, for I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is an image that comes to mind often for me, I think for many of us, Matthew 25. He says he'll separate people like a shepherd separates sheep and goats, telling the righteous, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. It's because whenever you were serving those who were hungry, thirsty, sick, naked, sojourning, or in prison, you were actually serving me. And then he turns to the wicked and then he says, where's my left? He says, he turns to the left. He says, is where he says, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels, because you didn't do these things, right? Go be with your gods. And the entire Sermon on the Mount is just him saying, he's not only showing us the way of life, but he's also making it very abundantly clear that it's impossible to obey these commands of God if we consider the current state of our condition of humanity. But hidden in plain sight, so we just heard him say, I've come to fulfill them. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, as we know, they've long hatched this plan where his perfect justice and his perfect love would both be perfectly satisfied. And so the Son was delivered up to be crucified. What we have with the cross tells us that as our psalm says, he considers our frame and our weakness. He doesn't leave us to strive and figure it out. The cross tells us that the one who obeyed God's every command, yedeav, the one who fears the Lord, switched places with us to be sacrificed like a perfect spotless lamb led to slaughter. And the cross tells us to come like a child, empty-handed as we really are, and just believe in the one that God sent. And then you can sing, he does not treat us as our sins deserve, because he treated Christ as my sins deserve, so that he could crown us with steadfast love and mercy. And he gave us the assurance, yes, you will rise just as I rose again. And moreover, he gives you the assurance that you are my child and you can't sin your way out of my love any more than you could have worked your way into it. Right? He says in this psalm, for as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove his our transgressions from us. Pastor Derek pointed this out for me. You can't even say those words without describing a cross. And if that's coincidence, I don't know, but we know how the Lord works. So that brings us to point two. So my perception of how he looks at me. This psalm, again, like few others, it just grabs you by the collar and it shouts, do you understand how he looks at you? His finger's not on the trigger. So when I feel like my sins are cast maybe 20 yards off, like far enough to where he could still grab them and whack me with them if he needs to. No, he says, as far as the east is from the west, they are gone. And as the father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. He's just piling on these analogies, right? I'm like a father to his needy child. I'm like a mother in Isaiah. I'm like a mother to her nursing child. Look at this one. Can a woman forget her nursing child that she should have no compassion on the son of her womb? Even these may forget, yet I will not forget you. Behold, I have you engraved on the palms of my hands. And there it is. There's the cross again. It's so easy, though, for us to hear this. And then we take poor relationships and we project that onto God, right? Maybe it's a poor father example. So the father analogy, you know, just doesn't land on you. Toxic romantic relationships. People, peers at work or peers at school, but goodness, at work, grown adults even, that make themselves feel better by putting you down. Maybe you can't even point to a single relationship that made you feel like you mattered immensely to that person and that nothing you did, good or bad, could ever change how amazing you were to that person. Right? But you have a God that says, listen, you're not a burden to me. Who gave you that idea? I don't have any regrets in saving you. Whatever we have to battle together, I'm here for it. So we're all hungering for this. And, you know, to take probably a fairly common, relatable example, you ever watch someone's face while you're talking to them? I'm doing it now. But to say, am I putting them off? Did I say something wrong? And when you hear that same person sharing how much they love or admire something very specific about you behind your back, right? Doesn't that feel amazing? So you take that, and we experience that. But God talks about us in the third person all over Scripture with adoration. And when people do it, you go, yeah, but if they really knew my heart, which first of all, yes, we should be able to take a compliment and give glory to God, first of all. But let's say, yes, if they knew your heart, this person maybe might not be able to handle it. Well, God knows your heart. And he said, I'm not going anywhere. So more importantly, just on top of that, that's the reason you can have peace no matter what people think about you or don't think about you, what they say about you or don't say about you, which brings us to our last point here, and this is, what's my response to this? And the response is to look back to point two. So to bless the Lord with all that's within me, to even fear him and to remember to do his commandments, I have to go back to point two. We've read James 1 before where it says, but be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror, for he looks at himself and goes away and at once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law, the law of liberty, which is a great phrase, and the law of liberty and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in his doing. So I love that phrase, the law of liberty, that translation. One illustration I've heard on this is of a physics professor who, and Tim's in this one, so this is to you then, whose course was famously difficult. And on the first day of class, the students are sitting there and they're nervous, and the professor walks in and he says, first thing, he says, you all have an A, and let's just enjoy the material. And so you have one group of students that's saying, oh my goodness, you mean we don't have to worry about test results and grading? We can just enjoy this? And the odd thing that happens is another group of students, same class, they come in and they hear the same news and they say, well, why did I buy this expensive textbook? Why come to class at all? And, you know, let's go hang out somewhere. What I want us to take from that is you obey to the degree that you've tasted that the Lord is good. That is 1 Peter chapter 2. And also because we have the promise of the Holy Spirit, as we know, not just as an occasional visitor, like in the Old Testament, but for him to live in us and animate us. So when we look in the mirror then, as James says, we're not seeing our shame or even our accomplishments. We see Christ looking back at us. So that's why you read about this in the New Testament. You see people burning their dark magic books that brought their livelihood, people pulling together their resources, their money and their resources together to love each other. For 2,000 years, people being brutally murdered because they found Christ and they wouldn't let go of it, no matter what it cost them physically or socially. And you get there when you can say, he is worthy of it all. Like, I haven't even seen his face yet, and I miss him already. And me, I can share the good news. I can care for my neighbor in secret without seeking some attention or benefit from it. And that's when I look at Christ, and I can truly believe that I'm not the generous one in this relationship. And that's what I have to constantly remind myself that. Forget not all his benefits. So as we close, I want us to remind our soul of who he really is. Like, look at how he looks at you. And let that cause your soul to bless the Lord, to worship. So as we transition to communion, if you've been given faith to trust in Christ, what we do now with communion is a command and also a gift. If you don't know him in this way, we ask that you take this time, think and pray through it. I pray that you'll see this steadfast love chasing after you the way I've described. He provides the meal. It's his body. It's his blood. He says, just take and eat and live. So the bread, the juice, and the wine are a celebration of that. So I'll pray and then I'll call us forward. Father, we need you. We needed you. You came and provided all that was needed. Thank you that we can sing praises to you in light of the work being finished on our behalf. Help us as we celebrate around the table, Lord, that it would cause us to love you more with our heart, soul, mind, and strength, to love each other and our neighbor as ourselves. In Jesus' name. What we'll have here is we'll have four servers up front. Please enter from the carpet runners, but what we'll do is you can exit on either the sides here or through these middle aisles. Show the middle aisle and these people some love here. Thank you all, and come when you're ready.